Do I have green light to start? Okay. Welcome, everybody, to this last session organized by the Dutch Committee of IUCN. It's an exhibition, so you can enjoy your drinks and food while we talk about the jaguar today again. Earlier today, we talked about an imminent threat of the jaguar, the illegal wildlife trade on jaguar parts. Today, we're going to speak about the jaguar from the people's perspective and the different values that jaguars have for people and nature. So we will take you with us through a journey with filmmakers, with scientists and anthropologists and biologists to see how we can learn from them to involve local people in the conservation of jaguars. One of the conclusions today earlier was that we need to involve them as part of the big effort to conserve jaguars. So if technology works well, I hope to have Simon as the first, not the speaker, but he will introduce his documentary called Jaguar, Voice of a Territory. He's from Colombia. Simon, I want to check with you if you're there and if you are online.
Yes, hello, I'm here.
Okay, please, Simon, can you introduce just in 1 minute or two your documentary?
Hi, hello, my name is Simon Gonzalez. I am the director and producer of Jaguar, Voice of a Territory. First of all, I would like to say thank you to the Jaguar and to my ancestors for giving me the chance of being here in this important event. Jaguar, Voice of a Territory is a film that took more than 10 years of long walking distance through the jungles, through the deep rivers of the Jaguar territory, walking with the communities indigenous, and having the opportunity of understanding how jaguar is important for humans and the relationship that they have been having for thousands of years. And this is what we are trying to share with everyone, because I believe human beings need to live in a proper way. And what I learned so far through the jaguar, through my ancestors, is that we all deserve to live as nature, as proper human beings, in a proper relationship with nature. And this is what we did in a film that took us more than 10 years. And I'm glad I have the chance to share this message with everybody here in this event. Thank you.
Thank you, Simone, for your words. And now we will see the trailer.
Aquí donde debo estar junto a ti, es aquí donde quiero estar junto a ti. Y a quien he venido a escuchar, es a ti a quien quiero venirte a hablar, es a ti a quien quiero los ojos mirar, es a ti a quien quiero fuerte abrazar, es a ti a quien quiero venir a llorar. Es a ti a quien quiero profundo amar. Es en ti donde me puedo mirar. Es en ti donde me puedo encontrar.
Yeah. Eso es volver al vientre de la madre y cuidar la Pachamama.
Hola a todos, mi nombre es Felipe Sucena.
Another talk. So Simón Jaguar, Voz de un Territorio. The Voice of a Territory is the film made by Simón. You can see it online. Not online, but you can buy it online if you want to see it. I recommend to do it. It's really a beautiful documentary and it connects you to Colombia. Thank you, Simón. You stay with us. For people who has questions, please keep them, and the people from the YouTube, you can share the questions with us through the chat, and we will ask the questions at the end. So thank you, Simón, and stay with us.
Thank you very much.
And next we have next speaker, Lucía Huaita. She's from my team. Lucía is an environmental scientist. You correct me, Lucía, if I'm not saying it correctly. Lucía worked with me in a literature review that we did for a couple of months now, reviewing all the literature about jaguars. And she did a great job, and the findings are very, very interesting. So we hope to have a publication soon about this. So Lucía, please go ahead with your presentation.
Thank you, Liliana. So, well, after this wonderful trailer of Jaguar Voice of a Territory, I would like for us to continue this journey. And this time, we're going to embark on a literature journey into the power of the jaguar. And through this journey, we have been reading hundreds of papers by anthropologists, conservationists, and archaeologists about the symbolic and ontological value of jaguars in indigenous and local communities across Latin America. Next slide. Throughout this literature journey, we have been reading about the cultural, historical, but also the spiritual interactions between jaguars and humans. And this literature review includes studies, stories, reports from 13 countries, and in which more than 30 indigenous groups are represented, but also many local communities living in Central America, the Amazon region, and also the northern part of Argentina. Next slide. And across our literature analysis, we concluded that there are two main commonly described ways in which humans and jaguars interact. The first one is the practice of shamanism, and the second one is the practice of dreaming. There are also many different types of themes, such as local perception, conflicts, taboo, or hunting, but also there are the perception of the jaguar as a god or a mythical figure, or the jaguar as being part of rituals and iconography. Next slide. So let's dig a bit more into who or what is the jaguar. Next slide. So there are two main ways of defining a jaguar. Jaguar can be a source of strength, of cunning, of majesty, but the jaguar can also be a symbol of darkness and destruction. In the Aztec time, the jaguars were a scary predator. And due to the fact that they could see in the dark, they were most commonly compared with the diviners, which also had the gift to be looking into the darkness of human future. Then in Mesoamerica, the jaguar was, but still is for some community, the god of rain. And this is because the roar of the jaguar resembles the sound of the roar of a thunder. While during the colonial times, the jaguar became a demonic figure, and whoever was suspected to be turning into a jaguar was accused of witchcraft. Next slide. So in our literature journey, we frequently came across this process of man becoming a jaguar. So how does that happen? Next slide. So based on the accounts of Robin Wright on the Baniwa people in the northwest of the Amazon, there are some people who actually can transform into jaguars. But these are not common humans. They are shamans. And they are not just shamans. They are shamans who survived lethal sicknesses or extraordinary dreams or intense trance experiences. And after that, they underwent very complex training to become jaguar shamans. And this is also why the jaguar shamans are the highest grade of healers and protectors for the community. A jaguar shaman has a tremendous power in the community. He can directly experience gods and spirits in all the levels of the cosmos. He can transform into the spirit of the jaguar. And it can also control the weather. And jaguar shamanism is not only a practice which is diffused among the Baniwa people, but also among numerous other indigenous communities in the Amazon region. And in the most recent centuries, evangelism has forced the abandonment of numerous sacred ceremonies or practices, including the practice of jaguar shamanism. And there is an issue with that in many communities, since the jaguar shamans were the only ones empowered to handle sorcery. Now sorcery has gone out of control. Next slide. And there are also numerous rules that someone shall follow when encountering a jaguar in the forest. Next slide. So according to the accounts of Eduardo Kuhn about the Runa people of Avila in Ecuador, if you encounter a jaguar in the forest, you must never look away. If you return the gaze, the jaguar will treat you as a subject, as an interlocutor. But if by contrast, you look away, you will become an object, which literally means dead meat. So only by returning this gaze, you won't be considered anymore a prey, but you will maintain that ontological parity as a predator, like the jaguar. And this is also part of the process of becoming a jaguar. And finally, the runa who survived such encounters with the jaguar are by definition called the runa puma, which literally means jaguar human. And becoming a runa puma translates into new possibilities to be recognized by your own community. Next slide. And through the lenses of conservations, humans and jaguars have shaped different ways to coexist with each other. Next slide. So in this coexistence, and based on the analysis of on Northern Argentina by Flavia Caruso and other researchers, local communities tend to have a positive attitude towards jaguar when there is an economic benefit from the presence of jaguars, such as, for instance, ecotourism. On the other side, the negative attitude can be influenced by the fear and the perception of jaguar as a threat to humans. And then based on analysis on Costa Rica, Jennifer Rebecca Kelly concludes that there is this historical memory of jaguar attacks and killings, which enforces the fear, that makes the fear being alive, even after years, even after generations. Even when these attacks haven't occurred in many years, still these stories that continue to circulate enforce the fear towards jaguars. And then through another perspective, Silvio Marchini, based in the Pantanal, suggests to conservation programs not to assume that there is a simple cause-effect relation in these human-jaguar conflicts, because most of the times this tension is influenced by a vast range of direct and indirect factors. Next slide. And finally, the last topic is the one of the use of jaguar and jaguar parts for cultural purposes. So how and why are these parts used in different cultures. So in Peru, for instance, the Yagua people eat jaguars at a beating heart. And this is because from this practice, they can gain the courage and the strength in view of important events, such as hunts or fights against enemies. While in Ecuador, the Runa of Avila drink the bile of jaguars to facilitate the communication with jaguars. And eventually, there is this process of soul transfer. In Colombia, the Tanimuca and the Yucuna wear jaguar teeth necklaces because it is thought that in each teeth, there is very valuable knowledge stored inside. But there are also rituals which see the killing of jaguars to increase the predatory potency of a community or a group. Centuries ago, the Tupinambá used to perform this youth initiation ritual, which included the killing of a jaguar in the main plaza of the village. And these corpses were used as a substitute for human captives. Also, a last example is the one of the Paracaña, which dance around the jaguar corpse as a part as a way to enhance the process of dreaming. Next slide. Here are some references on which I based this story, this literature journey. And here are some personal reflections, which I draw from this literature review. So first of all, the jaguar can be many things for different people, but it is also true that humans can also be many things. The presence of jaguars shapes cultures and advances the reflection on what is the role of human beings. Also, jaguars are integral part of indigenous communities' power structures. And lastly, the presence of jaguars generate social and cultural benefits, which cannot be accounted in economic terms. Next slide. Thank you a lot for listening. And yeah.
Thank you to you.
Thanks, Jana.
Very nice presentation and incredible. I know how many papers you read to prepare this, and the summary is excellent. So thank you so much. You will stay with us for questions. And yes, again, thank you so much for your incredible work. And our next speaker will zoom in one of these cultures, Barbara Arisi. She's an anthropologist working for the Vrije Universiteit in the Netherlands. And with her presentation, we will go to Brazil, one of the regions with the highest numbers of uncontacted people, to the Matisse groups in Brazil. So, if you please join us.
Hello, everybody. Are you still alive in this amazing good Congress? Are you all here doing your best to defend biodiversity? Because that's what I am doing here. So this is my new study about Dutch and the indigenous people. They are my new indigenous people, the Dutch. But today I'm going to present about my study that I do since 2003. I'm going to introduce myself. My name is Barbara Arisi. I'm Brazilian, also Italian. I live in the Netherlands. I speak also Dutch. That's why I'm invited as a teacher from the University of Amsterdam. I'm going to talk about the mesmerizing Amazonian beauty, indigenous people, and their jaguar dots. I'm gonna wait for you to zoom in for me. So that's my title. I work for the Vrije Universiteit. That's the phoenix. It's the symbol of the Vrije Universiteit. It means free university for the ones who don't speak Dutch. We can go. Those are my people. I was adopted there. I have a pleasure and the big honor of being called daughter. I'm going to strip a bit because it's hot here in Marseille. It's part of my show for you to keep you guys at the end of this Congress alive and paying attention. Matisse jaguar and their dots. Here we see an elder designing for me. That's my fieldwork picture. He's trying to explain to me what it means, atsasibo. It's a good hunter. In fact, the jaguar takes the central place of power among many Amazonian indigenous people. So as Lucia Guaita said, les jaguars sont superb. For my colleagues that don't speak French, and I'm so sorry. I hope we can translate for you my presentation later. The jaguar takes also this role there as a supreme hunter. And so take the Matisse. They have this jaguar body painting that's part of the inauguration of a longhouse that I participated there in 2009 of the construction. Go on. They were twice the cover of National Geographic because of their power, jaguar, mesmerizing beauty. This is Tepi Pagé, Tepi Shaman. He died because he was twice got instilled with a poison from the surucucu. So did I, but I survived mine and that was the first one. So I'm also on my way to becoming a shaman, but I am still a student with my big shaman ladies that are my mentors on that. Tepi was one of my mentors. I made a picture of him a few years after this was taken in 2003. Can go. Just go on. Yeah. Oh, it doesn't go to the front. But yeah, that's the picture I made of him. And what Lucia said makes a lot of sense, because if you look the jaguar in the eyes, and now you have the pleasure of looking at the eyes of one, that is a Matisse shaman that was looking to me with all his mesmerizing beauty. And they don't like to be called the jaguar people. They don't like the filmmakers call them. They look like a jaguar because they have those face tattoos. Made is a tatouage, the lines different, and then here too, then here and here. And they have on the next picture, they have also the mimetizing capabilities of other animals. Here we have a capivara, that's another party, another ritual. We can go on. This is my father who adopted me, Cheman. I have also two mothers that adopted me, and that he is preparing his youngest son to dance like a wild pig, the queixada in Portuguese, the pecari. They also dress like pecari. To the front always. That's the area where they live. It's the very heart of the Vale do Javari. As Liliana said, 8.5 million hectare of forest. Now we live in the Netherlands. Let's try to bring the Dutch public there. It's 2,000 kilometers by bike around the circumference. Now, if you prefer walking because you're French, a grand randonnée in the Amazonie, 2,000 kilometers, 2,000 kilometers. Oh, yeah. There. Today there was art moving there. I think it's because the Indians are trying here to talk about the power of this spirit from the Amazon Cuenca, from the Amazon Basin, that there was for the first time 4.8 on the Richter degrees. An earthquake. Thank you. Liliana is helping me because we are speaking so many languages here. We are in a shamanic work here. Shamanic work defending biodiversity with our spirits on our side. We are going to zoom in the area. That's the biggest concentration of indigenous uncontacted. The Matisse lives right there in the middle. So we can go on. It's very slow. It's good. We are slow. It's slow. Low, slow process. Those are the Matisse and their beauty. The men are on the left side. The women were on the right side. Nobody asked them. They stayed like that. I made the picture because we are inaugurating this longhouse. The Matisse have this myth about the jaguar who got stolen. Because one of the dots about the jaguars is that the jaguar, in many Amazonian myths, is the owner of the fire, so as Lucia said. And the bacurau is very interesting bird that I don't know the name, because if you enter on the internet, there's just bacurau. It's from that Amazon. He thought, why the jaguar always eats cooked? He has the fire, and we not. Lévi-Strauss wrote about that, the first mythologique, Le Cru et Le Cuit, the cooked and the raw, o cru e o cozido. And then this bacurau thought, I'm going to steal this fire. It is one of us, this bacurau. So he go there, steal the fire from the jaguar. And the jaguar says, I'm going to kill you now. So the jaguar goes to the middle of the lake, and he stays there, flying, very afraid of the jaguar, for as long as he could do. And then in a certain moment, he couldn't do it anymore, and he let the fire drop. Gone was the fire in the water of the river. And then the bacurau kept on eating raw. But the jaguar was like, how do I eat? How do I eat? I'm translating a myth, but the myth is much more beautiful in my language. Matisse. No, I'm not going to do it for you. I will do it after. How can I eat? How can I eat? I'm so hungry. I'm so hungry. Then he thought, oh, I'm going to look at those other people, the Matisse. And they were painted red. And then he thought, oh, they also eat raw. So the jaguar started eating raw, but then he was puking. He was not feeling good. And after he kept on trying, he finally could eat raw meat. And since then, the jaguar started eating raw. How the Matisse got the fire is another story for another night around our fire. Here we can go on. Here they are dressed like birds. Here they are also dressed like birds. That's the peak of the bird. And those dots, the jaguar dots, are back there. It took me very long to see, because one of the big powers of the jaguar that is very appreciated by shamans and by everyone is that the jaguar is a beautiful mimetic animal. He goes into a forest and he's on the lookout, and that's why he's the top predator. He can be visible and invisible at his own will. So the Matisse gave me those bracelets, and I have two here. We cannot zoom in, but you can see there. I scanned one of mine, and it took me very long. And then one day I was just looking at those biologists' identities, they call, because they all have a different, like the whales that never have the same design on the fin. They also never have the same design, and I'm talking here to specialists. You guys know better than me that those are the identity of each jaguar. Has a different, beautiful, beautiful weaving. So the Matisse weave their relationship with the jaguar by weaving their bracelets. That's took me long to see what it was, the connection. I understood that it was the dots, because they have different ones, like the big jaguar. It's this one here. I gave to an Amazonian leader who is now talking in the assembly. So it's full of shamanic power for real. But I said to him, I need for my presentation. So I took it. And that's mine. It's a gato maracajá, because I'm a lady. They gave me a gato maracajá. And the dots, then one day I went to bed trying to write my thesis. That was in 2010. I was nervous trying to write my thesis. And then I stayed the whole day relaxed, looking at a lot of jaguar beautiful designs and thinking that will come. I will understand why it is. And then I went to bed and I dreamed, and I could totally see why, of course. They are the losangos, the rosetas, what the biologists call the roseta. The black hairs are a bit higher than the yellow ones, so they stand out. And that's what they show in their up and down of the weaving, their relationship with the with this going up and down of the hairs of the jaguar. We can go on. So now we understand better. That first picture was just a bit of his back. And here we see the Ikbo from the longhouse, the head guy of the longhouse. He's being painted to be shown, because they are inaugurating that longhouse we saw before. can go on. The mesmerizing beauty of the Matisse never stops surprising filmmakers, anthropologists, everybody that has the chance to see them has this indruk, that is the Netherlands word, has this impact, is like, has this power of the beauty, the mesmerizing beauty of the Amazon. And here we see this hanging from his nose is an adorn that Philippe Erickson, my colleague, studying there, he studied there in the 80s. And he says they have the mark of the ancestors. But the mark of the ancestors and the mark of the jaguar and is there because they have this like the teeth of the jaguar, but it's made from a shell from Amazon that they collect and polish very carefully. And the earrings are made also from the shell. And the dots come again, the dots come again on the hats. And this is the teacher of the of one of the villages, the teacher for the children. And now you must be all tired because this is Congress is taking our energy and also our jaguar powers, but we need to be the jaguar powers protecting our forests of the Amazon. And I hope we are gonna join the ladies who are doing it. Now I'm making a propaganda moment for the indigenous people because they are here busy with the Cuencas Sagradas de la Amazonia. So that's the QR code. And they are also busy with talking about the taking care of the sacred. And that's the end of my story. Thank you. Merci. Atet B. And that's my daughter. Yeah, my young daughter. She is there making friends with one of my little cousins. And they were in the Javari River, where today this earthquake happens. I think it's the Mother Earth calling us for action. We have a bit of time, so I will give the microphone back to my dear Liliana. And thank you for the attention.
Thank you, Barbara. Thank you so much for this beautiful presentation. Well, I have already a lot of questions, but we have to continue. And I thank you so much for being here. This is a very hot place to be in right now. And everyone is leaving and you're staying for us and for the Jaguar and to learn more about these people. So thank you. And I have a next speaker calling in from Rio de Janeiro. He's an anthropologist from the University of Sao Paulo. This is a very big mistake. Catholic University of Rio de Janeiro. And Felipe is also with us online, but because we didn't want to, you know, with internet, you never know if it is a good enough quality. We have pre-recorded a short contribution from his side. He studied the conservation NGOs, actually. So we are the object of study in the Pantanal region. And he's also with us for questions, if you have them. So please share.
Olá a todos. Meu nome é Felipe Susequinde. Eu vou falar um pouco sobre a experiência que eu tive no Pantanal. Entre os anos de 2006 e 2008, eu fiz uma série de viagens a essa região para conhecer projetos ligados à conservação da onça-pintada. Nessa época, eu pude conviver com pesquisadores, também com vaqueiros e outros funcionários que trabalhavam nas fazendas de gado, que sediavam esses projetos. E essa experiência resultou na minha tese de doutorado em antropologia social, que foi defendida em 2010 no Museu Nacional da Universidade Federal do Rio de Janeiro. Eu registrei nessa época depoimentos de pesquisadores que trabalhavam naquela região e eram referência no estudo do jaguar. Eles estavam ligados à Associação Pro Carnívoros, uma organização não governamental conservacionista voltada para o estudo e conservação dos carnívoros brasileiros. Entre esses depoimentos está o de Peter Krauschel, fundador da Pro Carnívoros e um dos pioneiros no estudo do jaguar em vida livre. Krauschel, infelizmente, está entre as mais de 570 mil vítimas da Covid-19 no Brasil, e eu gostaria de dedicar a ele essa fala. A partir do estudo pioneiro com jaguares desenvolvido no Pantanal no final da década de 1970 e início de 1980, George Schaller e Peter Crouchel observaram que o gado tinha se convertido em uma presa, entre aspas, natural da onça e não ocasional. Era de longe o animal mais disponível em termos de biomassa e compartilhava o campo com uma série de animais selvagens que fazem parte da dieta dos felinos. E esses são predadores oportunistas. Para lidar com isso, diferentes barreiras visuais e sonoras já foram testadas na busca de minimizar o conflito entre grandes predadores nativos e os criadores de gado, no caso, a onça pintada e a onça parda. Chama a atenção, no relato tanto de biólogos quanto de fazendeiros que coexistem com esses felinos, a capacidade de improviso deles às diferentes intervenções humanas na paisagem. Além das entrevistas com pesquisadores, fazendeiros e moradores locais, o trabalho que eu fiz no Pantanal se baseou numa pesquisa de campo etnográfica que acompanhou durante alguns meses as atividades de dois projetos, ambos coordenados pelo biólogo Fernando Azevedo, também da Fundação Pro Carnívoros. Foi graças à boa vontade dele e da sua equipe, à receptividade sem exigência de nenhuma contrapartida, que eu pude desenvolver essa pesquisa. E por isso serei sempre grato. Um desses dois era o projeto Gadonça, sediado na Fazenda São Francisco, uma propriedade com um total de 15 mil hectares, que concilia ecoturismo, pecuária bovina e produção de arroz irrigado no Pantanal do Rio Miranda, no Mato Grosso do Sul. A principal etapa da pesquisa de campo relacionada a este projeto havia sido realizada entre 2003 e 2004, mas algumas onças que foram capturadas nessa época ainda estavam sendo monitoradas em 2006, quando visitei a fazenda pela primeira vez. A observação de onças era o maior atrativo para o ecoturismo, sendo que o biólogo responsável pelo laboratório na época, meu amigo Henrique Concone, oferecia palestras aos visitantes, nas quais as narrativas eram guiadas pelos itens coletados no laboratório, como ossadas de animais e do gado, perfuradas pela poderosa mordida do jaguar na base do crânio. Entre as técnicas utilizadas na captura das onças durante o projeto, estavam o uso de cães farejadores, com a participação de caçadores nativos, e a utilização de armadilhas. Essas últimas eram compostas por grandes gaiolas de ferro com sistema de roldanas acionado a partir da entrada do animal. Na seção final dessas gaiolas, havia um trecho cercado onde era mantida uma presa viva, um filhote de porco que era alimentado regularmente enquanto a armadilha ficava montada. Uma das onças capturadas com esse tipo de armadilha gerou uma situação inusitada que despertou meu interesse e foi meu interesse ao ser relatada pelos pesquisadores. Essa onça estava com filhotes recém-nascidos e recebeu o nome de Elisa. Como vocês sabem, é costume nesse tipo de projeto que se atribua um nome ao animal nas capturas. Esses nomes correspondem às frequências específicas no sistema VHF das coleiras de rádio, na época ainda não equipadas com equipamento GPS. E depois, esses mesmos nomes são adotados, tinham sido adotados pelos guias de turismo e também pelos vaqueiros da fazenda, quando se referiam aos animais avistados ou que deixavam rastros. Na ocasião de sua captura, Elisa passou por um conjunto de procedimentos. Depois de ser sedada, suas medidas corporais foram registradas, foi pesada, teve o sangue coletado e, por fim, recebeu uma coleira com um radiotransmissor. Depois, foi solta em seu território. Pouco tempo mais tarde, entretanto, os pesquisadores encontraram Elisa novamente presa na mesma armadilha, no mesmo lugar. Era um fato inédito. Em geral, depois de um evento como esse, as onças passavam a evitar a gaiola e se tornavam mais difíceis de capturar. Ao ser capturada pela segunda vez, suas condições de saúde foram verificadas. Estava em perfeito estado, ainda amamentando seus filhotes. A coleira de rádio em funcionamento. Não havia por que sedá-la novamente e foi liberada. A armadilha foi levada então para um local alguns quilômetros adiante, mas para surpresa da equipe, nas semanas seguintes, a onça foi capturada mais 4 vezes. O roteiro se repetia. Ela se alimentava do porco que servia de isca e ficava presa ali até que os responsáveis pelas capturas chegassem e a libertassem. Esse comportamento inesperado, ao cair várias vezes na mesma armadilha, pode ser tratado como uma curiosidade e não rendeu, até onde eu tenho conhecimento, nenhum tipo de discussão em papers científicos. Era um acontecimento restrito às narrativas de campo. Na verdade, para evitar que ela fosse novamente capturada, a armadilha foi até retirada da área da fazenda onde havia estabelecido seu território. Há, contudo, e essa é minha aposta aqui, elementos interessantes a serem considerados nessa história. Tal fato não se repetiu com nenhum outro animal que participou do estudo. Mas o que me parece interessante é a ideia de explorar o dispositivo de captura sob outro ângulo, entendendo que os desdobramentos de sua utilização nem sempre fazem parte do projeto a partir do qual ele é concebido. O ponto é que Elisa, a onça, aprendeu de alguma forma que seria solta pelos seus captores humanos, e com isso se alimentava dos porcos fornecidos por eles, mesmo depois de todo o trauma da captura. Poderíamos dizer, nesse sentido, que ela domesticou a armadilha e também seus captores, contando com eles para soltá-la depois que tivesse comido o porquinho, bem fornecido e bem alimentado. Algumas onças de coleira ainda estavam sendo avistadas em 2008, quando voltei à fazenda, apesar dos aparelhos não funcionarem mais. Uma delas era Elisa. Nessa época, 2 machos identificados como filhos dela, chamados Grandão e Orelha, estavam sendo avistados com frequência por pesquisadores, guias e turistas. Os pesquisadores lamentavam que os animais não estivessem sendo monitorados pelo projeto por meio da telemetria, mas era surpreendente para todos que estivessem sendo observados andando juntos até a idade adulta, quando a expectativa era que estabelecessem territórios individuais a partir do momento que se separaram da mãe. Em 2007, na cidade de Miranda, tive a oportunidade de conversar também com outra pesquisadora que é uma referência nesse campo, Sandra Cavalcante. Ela havia concluído recentemente suas atividades de pesquisa no Mato Grosso do Sul e preparava os dados para publicação. Seu trabalho questionava uma série de paradigmas anteriores estabelecidos a respeito do jaguar, como a ideia do animal-problema ou o modelo do macho dominante, que explicava o uso das áreas pelos felinos. O caráter androcêntrico da ideia do macho dominante foi colocado em xeque na medida em que os resultados do estudo apontavam para uma estabilidade no território das fêmeas e para uma grande circulação dos machos por esses mesmos territórios. O modo como as áreas se superpunham e a quantidade de interações entre as onças de ambos os sexos também eram surpreendentes, o que levou a pesquisadora a observar, nesse depoimento, que o caráter solitário do comportamento dos felinos, contrastado muitas vezes ao caráter gregário dos cães que vivem em matilhas, não se oporia necessariamente à ideia de socialização, o que pode ser corroborado, talvez, pela observação desses 2 irmãos, filhotes de Elisa, andando juntos na Fazenda São Francisco. Para concluir, observo que muitas vezes, em diferentes campos, as capacidades, tanto humanas quanto animais, são tratadas em termos deterministas, que obedecem a condições pré-definidas. Isso sendo uma linguagem funcionalista nas ciências sociais, centradas em noções como individualismo, estrutura social, quanto em áreas das ciências naturais, que entendem os comportamentos animais em termos de mecanismos inatos, automatizados, instintos que estão subordinados ao etograma de cada espécie. Em contrapartida, podemos pensar em modelos que levem em conta a criatividade e o caráter complementar entre organismos e ambientes, sujeitos e sociedades. Nas experiências de campo, são recorrentes observações acerca das idiosincrasias, comportamentos diferenciantes e preferências alimentares das onças, seja por parte de pesquisadores e cientistas, seja por parte de conhecedores locais. O mundo das onças, impossível não reconhecermos isso, está passando por transformações intensas e radicais. Agora mesmo, estamos seca e o fogo está voltando com força no Pantanal e na Amazônia. Mudanças climáticas, alterações da paisagem e das condições de vida, introdução de elementos ligados às infraestruturas humanas, novas doenças trazidas por animais domésticos, ofertas de alimento, barreiras, cercas, estradas. Tudo isso são ameaças e oportunidades. Nesse sentido, é que entendo que o exemplo de Elisa aponta um caminho possível, ligado às capacidades de aprendizado e improviso, às trajetórias próprias e ao modo como cada indivíduo de uma espécie está envolvido em um processo ativo de construção de um mundo possível. As onças respondem ao conjunto de possibilidades oferecidos pelo seu ambiente, adaptam-se a ele, mas também tornam habitável esse mesmo ambiente ao modificar as condições que se oferecem. Obrigado, é isso.
Obrigado, Felipe. Thank you for sharing with us a story about Elisa, Aurelia, and Grandal. Interesting for conservation NGOs also to learn from this perspective and how much we sometimes project from the human structures into animals. We will keep you for possible questions at the end, Felipe. And I want to do an experiment now with Maria Fernanda. If she is there, we can connect with her directly. Maria Fernanda, she is an incredible young conservationist from Venezuela. And as you know, Venezuela is having many, many difficulties, and conservationists and indigenous peoples where she works are having the most difficult time. So I wonder if we can connect with her live. It's always a challenge to, if you are there, Maria Fernanda, maybe you can briefly introduce yourself. I want to make use of the good connection. Maria Fernanda went to visit.
Hello?
Yes, you are there. Go ahead, Maria Fernanda.
Hello, everyone.
Can we see her?
Sorry, I can show my camera.
Oh. She is calling from, where are you now, Maria Fernanda?
Hello.
In Caracas?
Yes, here in Caracas. I'm in Caracas right now.
And
hello, everyone.
So good. So please go ahead. Say hello to the audience.
Hello, everyone. My name is Maria Fernanda Puerto Carrillo. And I am a Venezuelan biologist and conservationist working since 2007 to preserve the biggest cat in America, the jaguar, evaluating the state of their populations and the main threats that they are facing here in Venezuela, like us, like the Venezuelan people, and especially how it is the relation between this big cat and local and indigenous communities. I'm grateful to be here today with all of you, and thank you.
Yes, Maria Fernanda, I almost feel sorry that we pre-recorded this session because I have never had this connection with you. This is the first time I have you so clear, and internet is working perfectly well. So
yes,
yes.
I don't know. How has it happened?
I don't know, it's a miracle. So
Yes.
Is the shaman is working. Yeah, maybe it's the strength of the shamans. But Maria Fernanda visited South Venezuela just a couple of weeks ago, and is a very difficult area to reach. She had an accident, but she came back safe, luckily. But we have a small video again with her contribution about that trip.
Hola, mi nombre es María Fernanda Puerto, soy bióloga venezolana, egresada de la Universidad del Zulia y actualmente me encuentro terminando mi maestría en el Instituto Venezolano de Investigaciones Científicas. Hoy vengo a hablarles sobre el trabajo que he venido realizando con el felino más grande del continente americano, que es el jaguar. Desde el año 2007 he trabajado principalmente en la zona del sur del lago de Maracaibo, conociendo o evaluando la situación actual de este felino en esta región del país, una región que ha sido considerada como una de las zonas donde las poblaciones jaguares están más en estado más crítico. El jaguar es el felino de mayor envergadura en todo el continente americano, por supuesto en Venezuela también, y ha sido catalogado en Venezuela como una especie vulnerable a la extinción debido a la fragmentación y pérdida de hábitat, a la disminución de las presas naturales, cacería por represalias. En algunos casos, como en Venezuela, hay uso de este felino para rituales religiosos o inclusive para una demostración de poder grupos irregulares, así que bueno, la idea era identificar todo este tipo de amenazas durante todo este tiempo. Sin embargo, el jaguar no solamente está distribuido en esta zona del país, sino que se encuentra distribuido en gran parte del territorio venezolano, inclusive la región del sur, lo que se conoce como la región del sur de Vela, que es el sur del río Orinoco, se cree que es una de las poblaciones que se encuentra más estable de todas las poblaciones que habitan el país. Por esa razón, este año decidimos iniciar un nuevo proyecto en el norte del estado Amazonas, incluyendo las comunidades indígenas, en este caso, la segunda comunidad indígena más grande de Venezuela, que es la Piaroa o Wotuhap, que se les llama así en su nombre original. Y decidimos iniciar este proyecto para saber realmente cómo está la población de jaguares en esta zona y cuáles amenazas está enfrentando esta especie en esta región. Por esta razón, hace un par de semanas, viajando desde Caracas hasta Puerto Ayacucho. Puerto Ayacucho es la capital del estado Amazonas y luego de casi 14 horas de viaje llegamos a esta zona y de allí viajamos a lo que se conoce como la cuenca del río Cataniapo, que el río Cataniapo viene a ser parte de lo que es la cuenca o un brazo de la cuenca más grande de Venezuela, que es del río Orinoco, y trabajaríamos con las comunidades indígenas piaroas de esa región. Llegamos en primer momento a la comunidad Sardi, que digamos que es como la primera comunidad que se le puede llegar en tierra, en vehículo, y nosotros al llegar a la comunidad fuimos recibidos por el capitán de la zona, ¿verdad? Y personas de la comunidad, como es el protocolo o la forma adecuada de hacer, es que se les comenta de qué va nuestro trabajo, qué es lo que queremos hacer, por qué lo queremos hacer y por qué específicamente decidimos trabajar en esas tierras. Luego de ser recibidos por el capitán y la familia, se hizo una consulta pública a la comunidad de Sardi, donde hicimos una presentación para mostrarles como ejemplo nuestro trabajo realizado desde el año 2007 hasta hace un año en la cuenca del sur del lago de Maracaibo. En este sentido, nosotros mostrábamos cómo se trabaja, qué estudios hemos realizado, les hablamos sobre cómo hacíamos el estudio de dieta, cómo era la recolecta de heces, cómo era la recolecta de material fotográfico, qué equipos usábamos, porque digamos que una de las cosas que queremos nosotros es mantener la claridad y la transparencia con las comunidades porque debido al enfrentamiento que está ocurriendo en la zona de grupos irregulares armados que quieren invadir estas tierras, ellos son muy cautelosos al momento de recibir personas de otras ciudades, ¿sí? Entonces nosotros por esta razón decidimos llevar estas presentaciones para que ellos pudieran ver y de primera mano todo el trabajo que nosotros queríamos iniciar en esta zona. En este sentido, nosotros hablamos con la comunidad por horas, debatimos sobre muchas de las cosas que de la historia, anécdotas, conocimos mucho sobre cómo ve el Piaroa o el pueblo Wotuja al jaguar, o como ellas le dicen, el Yeví, que es el nombre del jaguar que le dan al jaguar en su lengua. Y al ser aceptado, procedimos a la instalación de cámaras donde de manera sorpresiva vimos que los jóvenes de estas comunidades están muy dispuestos a querer aprender y a conocer a este gran felino. Este capitán que nos recibió en esta zona era un antiguo chamán. Él quizás nos dio una visión distinta de lo que representa el jaguar para la comunidad, y bueno, conocimos un poco sobre cuáles eran los principales conflictos, qué era lo que estaba ocurriendo, cómo veían y perciben estas comunidades ahora al jaguar, porque ha habido muchos cambios. Y bueno, entendimos, era un poco de este viaje, era entender también qué había cambiado, ¿no? En la cultura ancestral, de la cultura ancestral a lo que se vive actualmente. Luego de este trabajo en la comunidad Sardi, donde los jóvenes participaron en la instalación de las cámaras, iniciamos nuestro recorrido, nuestra visita a otros pueblos, en otras comunidades, río arriba del río Cataniapo, y llegamos a la comunidad San Pablo, una comunidad que nos recibió con mucho cariño, mucho amor, mucho agrado. Nos hablaron muchísimo sobre su visión del jaguar, y aún se practica los chamanes están activos, no hay tanta transculturización como en otras comunidades. Fuimos recibidos inclusive por los chamanes, dos chamanes de la comunidad. Uno de ellos presentaba como dentro de su vestimenta un collar donde tenía un colmillo de jaguar, y en la conversación que tuvimos con ellos consultamos cuál era la visión que tenía el chamán de el jaguar, cómo era esa transición, cómo ocurría, y nos explicaba un poco sobre cómo al usar el yopo había una transición del hombre, un cambio, ¿no? Del hombre se metía en el cuerpo de un jaguar, y esta es la forma en la que un chamán puede viajar a través del bosque de manera que pueda caminar larga distancia, ¿verdad? Para saber y visitar otras comunidades y saber así si hay enemigos que quieren atacar su aldea o su pueblo, su comunidad. Esa es la forma en la que el chamán, o históricamente o ancestralmente, el piaroa ve al jaguar, o usa de manera figurativa como deidad al jaguar de esta manera, ¿no? Y es así como el piaroa camina, como ellos dicen, caminamos lentos pero caminamos largo, es decir, que caminan mucho. Es la forma en la que el chamán transita el bosque largas distancias para saber si hay un riesgo a su comunidad. Esa es la visión ancestral que hay del jaguar en estas comunidades. Es un animal que genera protección. Ellos están muy conscientes de la importancia del jaguar, de la necesidad de proteger un animal como el jaguar, porque es el mayor depredador de los ecosistemas. Y inclusive les consultamos cuál era la finalidad de poseer un colmillo de jaguar dentro de su collar de protección, y es justamente eso, ellos son protegidos. El jaguar es la figura que representa al piaroa enyopado, como lo dicen ellos, y permite que el chamán transite y camine como el mismo jaguar o el mismo yeví, como ellos mismos le dicen, ¿verdad? A través del bosque. En esta comunidad la visión era algo distinta a como ocurría en la otra comunidad, porque ya en la otra comunidad han llegado misioneros, ha habido algunos cambios, pero sin embargo ambas comunidades conservan mucho su arraigo con la presencia del yeví o del jaguar. Una de las cosas que nos pareció interesante es que hubo que hacer una consulta pública a toda la comunidad para mostrar también todas nuestras imágenes, nuestro proyecto previo en el estado Zulia, para que ellos vieran cómo era el proceso de este trabajo. Y fue increíble el nivel de aceptación. Los jóvenes querían aprender y entender y estudiar al jaguar de una manera que no nos imaginábamos que iba a ocurrir. Estaban súper dispuestos a aprender. Fueron con nosotros a la instalación de algunas cámaras trampas, y fue increíble ver cómo ocurrió el aprendizaje, cómo aprendimos de ellos, cómo nos mostraban el bosque, cómo los sonidos de los animales eran interpretados por los indígenas, cómo ocurría esa interpretación. Inclusive el sonido de los bosques, sonidos de árboles cayendo, se conoce para ellos, para estas comunidades, como una forma del jaguar comunicarse y avisar que está presente en el bosque. Todo esto se fue como dando, estos conocimientos se iban dando a lo largo de caminar esta selva amazónica, ¿verdad? Y donde nos iban mostrando un poco sobre cómo ven ellos toda la fauna que envuelve este o que es parte de este ecosistema. Para nuestra sorpresa, se fue corriendo la voz, como decimos nosotros en Venezuela, se fue corriendo la voz de que estábamos en allí, que queríamos estudiar el yeví, y una de las comunidades que no conocíamos, que se llama Comunidad Caño Colorado, dos personas de la comunidad visitaron la comunidad de San Pablo y se nos acercaron y nos pidieron que trabajáramos en sus tierras, que querían trabajar para proteger al jaguar. Creo que fue de la parte de todos los bosques que habíamos recorrido, esta zona cuando entramos a lo que es el Caño Colorado, que es una ruta que ni siquiera habíamos evaluado para el viaje, porque no lo sabíamos, no lo conocíamos. Las personas de esta comunidad, una comunidad pequeña de al menos 200 personas, era increíble el nivel de aceptación. Estaban sumamente emocionados, no temían a las cámaras. Les mostrábamos los equipos para que entendieran lo que iban a ver alrededor en su bosque cuando ellos caminaran por allí. Y el nivel de aceptación fue tan grande que estábamos súper asombrados, sorprendidos. Igual, de la misma manera, los jóvenes fueron con nosotros, fueron nuestros guías. Llegamos a la selva, al corazón de la selva amazónica. De verdad que fue increíble y mágico. Y nos explicaban, inclusive allí, sobre cómo ven al jaguar. Nos preguntaban el por qué un animal ataca, por ejemplo, a un perro, o si es verdad que atacan los seres humanos, que, o sea, hay un temor, pero más un temor infundado, o sea, no es originado, originario de ellos, es más un temor ajeno, quizás de criollos, como nos llaman a nosotros, que han visitado previamente las comunidades, pero ellos mismos saben que el jaguar es sinónimo de bosque saludable. Ellos saben que al depredar presas hay un control, hay un equilibrio. Ellos lo llaman el dueño de la selva, ellos lo llaman tierra mágica, porque hay una conexión enorme entre la fauna y la flora y el agua. Para ellos es sumamente sagrado, los cuerpos son sumamente sagrados, los cuerpos de agua. La cacería inclusive se hace en sectores, no puede ser en cualquier parte. Hay zonas sagradas donde no se permite la cacería, inclusive no se permite la pesca en alguna zona. Así que bueno, parte de todo eso fue nuestra vivencia en estas comunidades, y por supuesto la idea de iniciar este proyecto ya a mayor escala es algo que nos emociona, porque bueno, ya hay una aceptación, se elaboraron actas de alianzas con las comunidades, todas las comunidades firmaron dicha acta, son como una comunidad indígena sumamente organizada, y bueno, realmente venimos con mucho positivismo en este nuevo proyecto, y esperamos pronto estar nuevamente visitando para saber qué salió en nuestras cámaras, iniciar este gran proyecto sobre densidad e ir entendiendo ese tema de la cacería, de las amenazas que enfrenta el jaguar, el tema de la minería y la deforestación, que digamos que está de alguna manera llegando a estas comunidades en zonas aledañas. Gracias.
You're still there, right? We are getting a lot of reactions from the YouTube people supporting you and saying how amazing you are and the work you do. So I wanted to share that with you. That's all in YouTube. You are getting a lot of messages of support from Venezuela. So again, an applause for you, because your work is a marvel.
Thank you.
Can you stay with us? And as a final contribution, I want to invite Liz Unger. Liz, are you there?
Yes.
We can see you now. Oh, there you are. Liz, well, we have been working for, I don't know how many years now, with this documentary. We have been supporting you as IUCN, and this documentary is finally there, finished after, I don't know, 7 years of your life. It's a big project. It's a beautiful documentary. Please introduce yourself to this audience.
Thanks, Liliana. Hi, everyone. My name is Elizabeth Unger, and I'm the director and producer of Tigre Gente, a documentary that exposes a new deadly jaguar trade for the Chinese black market. The inception for this film actually happened years ago. In 2009, I was volunteering at Oblivion Wildlife Refuge and working with victims of illegal black market, big cats specifically. And the experience had a big impact on me. I walked away with the realization that I really wanted to work on more wildlife trafficking stories in South America, particularly because the media was so focused on Africa at the time with the poaching of elephants and rhinos. And years later in 2015, I found myself back in Bolivia once more and found out from some local authorities that jaguar parts were being confiscated in packages that were being smuggled to China. And I knew from my background in biology and wildlife conservation that not many people in the conservation world were talking about it. So my team and I decided to, you know, knock on doors, trying to gain partners. We eventually began collaborating with IUCN Committee of the Netherlands, which has been a dream. They're fantastic. And a project that we thought was going to take 6 months ended up taking 6 years. And today I'm so proud to introduce Tigre Gente, a documentary that just had its world premiere at Tribeca Film Festival, one of the most premier film festivals in the world. And our film follows two characters, a Bolivian park ranger named Marcos, who works in Medidi National Park, and a young Hong Kongese journalist named Laurel. And both of these characters are investigating this new jaguar trade from opposite sides of the world. So we'd love to present a small teaser from Marcos's point of view during his work in Medidi National Park investigating this jaguar trade.
Considero que mi familia es es la vida silvestre, ¿no? Son mis hermanos. Es mi familia, es mi madre, es mi esposa. Son todos. Y dentro de eso, la naturaleza también es parte de mí. Bien, el Parque Nacional Madidi viene afrontando fuertes amenazas. Ha habido compromisos por parte del gobierno boliviano, del gobierno de China, para financiar los megaproyectos de desarrollo a nivel nacional. Y se nos presenta ahora una problemática con el tráfico de colmillos de jaguar que han estado promoviendo algunos ciudadanos chinos en las áreas circundantes al Parque Nacional Madidi. Entonces eso nos indica de que sí hay una red y lo vamos a investigar. De jaguar, de tigre. ¿Conocen a alguien? ¿Ha venido por aquí a preguntar?
No sabía, no.
¿Ah?
No sabía, no.
¿No sabía?
Sí, no sabía, no.
Ya. Para la policía, o sea, no lo ven como un problema serio, ¿no? Es un dientecito, o sea, ¿cuál es el problema, no? Te empiezas a pensar, ¿o será que están encubriendo? ¿O será que quieren proteger a alguien?
Ahí está la cabeza.
Ah, no era muy grande, ¿no?
No era muy grande.
¿Y era macho o hembra?
Macho era. Macho.
La mayoría seguramente preferirá dar un paso al costado o decir que no pasa nada por acá. No lo van a hacer los guardaparques. No lo vamos a admitir. No lo vamos a permitir. Me preocupa, pero dentro de mí dije que miedo únicamente le tengo a Dios. A nadie más, y no le voy a bajar la mirada a ningún traficante que se me presente enfrente mío. Ojalá que el tiempo nos dé para poder llegar a descubrir los peces gordos que llamamos.
Thanks. Tigre Gente is embarking on a international film festival run and a worldwide impact campaign that we're estimating will take about a couple years. If the project inspires you in any way, please reach out as we would love to collaborate during our strategy, you know, strategizing the next endeavor after making this very ambitious film. Thank you so much for your time, and I hope you enjoyed our presentation.
We did, Liz. Thank you so much. Something also that I wanted to share is that Marcos himself is also facing a lot of threats at the moment, so also important to share. I would like to open the floor for questions, and preferably if you have questions for Felipe, because I feel that I didn't give you enough attention. Felipe, we move forward, and are you there, Felipe? Yes. So if you have questions for him and the Lisa story, I would like to hear them. If not, yes. Can you come to the mic? So Felipe, first questions for you.
Bom dia, Felipe. Well, this is a question for you, but also it is open for the whole panelists that were sharing their experience, their projects. And so all of you have been conducting research or projects with a rich experience. It's so you've shared a very rich descriptions of the things that you've been doing, and especially for those that have gain a cosmovision or a very rich culture view between human groups or human populations and the Jaguar. Can you share some thoughts regarding how can we translate all these rich information that you collected from these human groups, how can we translate this information into practical actions that we can deliver to those conservationists or those practitioners in conservation? So it is for you, Felipe, but also if anyone feel, you know, like chip in and provide some insights. How can we translate this very rich information, very complex information into practical and pragmatic information for conservationists? Thank you.
I will take two questions because there is another one, and because we have short time, I would like to also to take the other one, and then you can choose, and we will go like a round of reactions.
Bom dia, boa noite, Felipe. Eu sou Carlos, guarda-parques de Colômbia. Felipe, Brasil é o produtor do gado principal do mundo, sim? Qual é o trabalho de la academia para contrarrestar la conservación do jaguar e trabalhar avec la comunidade local por uma produção do gado sustentável sem generar mais conflitos?
I can translate. Thank you for your question. I'm going to translate just for the audience that cannot understand Portuguese mixed with a charmant accent in French. He's asking, Felipe understood, I'm telling more our audience, and Lucia, for example. He asked, Brazil is one of the biggest productions of cattle. How can we, together with local people, local communities, people that live in those landscapes, to work for the conservation of the jaguars? I think that was, and Liliana can.
Both questions are very much related. So Felipe, we start with you, if you can.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the questions. I will be brief. The situation with cattle in Brazil, there is more cattle than people here in Brazil. And in Pantanal, I think Pantanal is a special place to this question because it's a place where people are raising cattle, and in a place where there is lots of wildlife. So in the same space. So to understand how jaguars became adapted to that reality, how they cattle became a part of their diet, and to deal with this conflict is the main worries and the difficulties to the conservation there. But I think it's a special place, like to understand that and to try to bring new deals and new possibilities to conservation. There is no simple answer to that. There are lots of experiences, like the farms that conservate jaguars, they have selo, they have a certification.
Like a stamp.
A certified
certification.
So that the meat they sell to the market have this certification. This is a possibility, but it's very difficult to implement as a big politic as to the entire country. But there are some local experiences that can be translated to a great scale. The first question, I think it's...
sufficient. I think I understand.
Okay.
It's very much so local solutions and then upscaling. And then the Pantanal is a good lab to learn how people and animals like jaguars are interacting and also adapting to each other. That's what I got. I don't know if someone else wants to react. We are here reaching the end of the session, so I would like to give you the opportunity, but please be brief. I don't see any hand. Mafia, are you still there? We lost her probably. We were lucky with the connection. I don't see any other hand. Oh, I see Lucia. Please go ahead, Lucia.
Yes, thank you. I will address the first question. So about like how can we translate some of those studies and research that we've been doing into something that is more practical for conservation. So for instance, I would feel like taking the presentation of Maria Fernanda, because she is a biologist, but still she took the time to listen. And I think this is probably how I will reply, taking the time to listen. So probably the more social part isn't, you know, the strength of conservation currently, maybe. Although a lot of work is being done on that. But I think her example is very nice and practical, because she really took the time, you know, to go to these communities, listen, understand, and now, you know, she'll be in the position to re-elaborate, you know, how can this be done? You know, like, there are positive reaction from the community. Let's take this and, you know, reinforce this. So I think that would be my response. Take the time to listen to people.
Thank you. Communication, important. And I have, Liz is working on communication. Simone is working communication, a different kind of communication. Barbara was telling a lot of, storytelling around the Matisse people. So the communication, connecting, it's important. I want to give you just the final word, because they will turn the light off here. Everything is closing. So just the final remarks.
I think I would just like to add, because they're really gone, we are the last standing. IUCN, the Netherlands, they are really, I've been observing there, because I was, you know, the anthropologist on board, and I was watching. And what we can teach, I think what we can interact is, how do we listen to the local communities, being anthropologists, being a filmmaker, being a photographer, being a biologist, having this respect, conservation of nature. Indigenous people knows how to do that. The native people know how to do that. We know, because we are scientists, and we know where the real knowledge is. And they are there in the ancestral knowledge. My English is gone now. But I think that's what this panel is about, listening to the people who know about jaguars. And those are the jaguar people, the people like Piaroa, like the Matias. They are the ones. Thank you.
The perfect way to close the panel. Thank you for staying with us till the end, and it's real the end. So thank you.